Sorry, Jill, I was diverted. Good morning, everyone. Good to see you on this lovely sunny morning. There are one or two things I just want to share with you. Kate has been in touch with Loretta, who moved to Quorn recently. There is a card on the back table, as we now have an address, so if you wish to add your good wishes, please sign it before you go home. Loretta says she's settling in gradually, but she misses us all. You may have noticed that in the back corner over there, work is in progress for our kitchenette. I am hoping that it may be completed tomorrow. I think most of the plumbing is done, and there's a bit of cosmetic decoration before it's finished. We are crossing our fingers tightly as I tell you that we hope to begin Lunchbox on May the 3rd. That'll be 12:30. It will be the soup and dessert for a start, because we've all been out of practice for so long. We found a three-course meal on the first day might just be a bit of a challenge. But we'll put a note out next Sunday, and if you're thinking you'd like to come, or know someone who does want to come, then if you'll sign up next week, that will be in time to do the shopping. We welcome Reverend Les Gill from South Leicestershire again after not too long. We're really pleased that you're here with us, and look forward to your message for us this morning. So, as we prepare to worship our God, I'll open the Bible and we'll be ready to begin.
Peace the Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. And a great happy Easter from Wixton Magna Church, where I was leading worship last Sunday. So words from the songs prepare us to come before the Lord. We give thanks, O Lord, with all our hearts. Before the world we sing your praise. We bow down towards your holy place and give thanks to you for your steadfast love and your faithfulness. For you have exalted your name and your word above everything. On the days when we call, you answer us. It is in your increased love and care that our souls receive the strength they need. So we stand as we're able to, going to sing our opening hymn, which is, O Lord, my God, with an eye of awesome wonder, how great thou art.
Amen.
Let's come before the throne of grace and pray. O loving Father God, as we gather in your house this morning, we do so in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, your greatest gift to humankind. For throughout the whole of the life of the creation, you have looked down upon what you have made with love and affection, and with a longing in your heart that we who are entrusted with this world and with one another, the whole human family, will rediscover a heart for you and for your purpose in our lives. In awe and wonder, we look at the universe and then gaze upon a tiny robin, and yet close up, its song is more deafening as it sings its heart out to you. So must we do so as well. We thank you, the Church. We thank you for Easter. We thank you for the wonderful, joyous message of the power of death overcome through your love. You call us again to trust, to learn to trust again as we emerge from the darkness and the cloud of COVID, to be a source of light and hope to our communities, that our homes may have open doors to welcome the refugee, that we can empty our pockets and our bank accounts and give generously to a world that needs, that we can reach out to those in the Ukraine who in their thousands today are fleeing back over their borders to Poland. For in the Orthodox side of our Church, they proclaim Christ risen this day. It is for them Easter. And their trust in you overcomes their fear of war. May we too relish and support them in all the ways that we can, as we are called to support this place, this community around Alice Road and further afield. Forgive us, Father, when we fall short, for those moments when we couldn't be bothered, we felt weary and life seemed just too much. In those moments, remind us that Jesus died for us, that Jesus gave his all, that we can continue to serve and love as we should. So when we have let each other down, forgive us. From the neighbor who has seemed far away and out of touch, forgive us. For our lack of study of your word and neglect of prayer, forgive us. As we come before you now in this time of worship, lift our minds, our hearts, our whole beings, so that we may walk with Christ in the world today, inspired by your Spirit, our Holy Spirit, in all that we do and say. And Jesus, in your time of mourners, you taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. chance to come together and celebrate Easter time. So there was a great wonder last Sunday that yes, we were no longer behind closed doors for fear of the virus. Like those early disciples for fear of the Jews, it's the sense of it was that commonality of understanding what it feels like as a Christian not to be able to trust, to be free, to have the faith that we need. But you know, trust and faith grows by what we share, and by what we do, by what we experience. I remember some years ago, a boy being in camp, we had a terrible storm, it was in Guernsey. And when we arrived at camp, there was some muddy sheets of polythene in one corner. We thought, you know what they're there for? But it was a Thursday night and the heavens opened. And it was a thunderstorm. And all of a sudden, there was this, I won't call it a tsunami, but certainly a good flow of water coming down the hill. And all the tents were on the hill, the ridge tent, and the water just swooped underneath over the ground sheets, leaving the young lads in their sleeping bags somewhat wet. And we as officers then dived in, and we realised what those bloody sheets were there for, so we grabbed those, we lifted the ground sheets, and put those underneath so the water flowed under. But I remember that night that there was one of the camp captains, Matthew, had a really torrid week there at the camp. Captain himself and others had put Matthew through the mill. It was his first time in charge of six rather unruly boys. And we know what unruly boys can be like, I've been one myself. But the thing is that just for a moment he came out of his tent, came over with his arms like that. So he came close and I put my arms around him and gave him a hug. And you think to yourself, can you do that today? Do you have it in the register somewhere? In the but those thoughts don't go through your head, do they? You learn to trust and just say, there's a young man here who needs something. And in the morning, Matthew came over. He says, thanks for that. That's not it. That was just what I needed. And some years later, with our pilots company in South Brixton, we had two young girls here. One was 9 and the other one was 5. They're, sadly, mum and dad had broken up in a rather very difficult way. And a lot of fear in these children when they came to us. But they heard from the other pilots that it's a good place to be. Whether they say you'll find me loved and cared for, I think what they shared suggests that would be the case. And the younger girl, yes, had some really serious behavioural problems. So one big evening, because she would always disrupt the games, Baz and myself decided to be young members of the team rather than the leaders. And she was put in charge. So as the session went on, we became very disobedient. And you could see the sort of emotions starting to rise. And then there was that eureka moment when she, her finger came up and she smiled and she pointed at it. She understood that what we were helping her to understand, this is how it spoils things for anybody else when we're distracted. Well, there were this about 9 months and then came the news that their mother was in a new loving relationship and they were about to move from Southwest to Leicester Forest East. Well, the week before they moved, I was actually going on holiday. And I remember at the end of the evening, the young girl, the 5-year-old, she had a smile of an angel, beautiful long, blonde hair. And she, toward the exit door, she just beckoned me to kneel down. And she put her arms around me. And she gave me a kiss. You can't ever forget those moments in life where learning to trust is born of taking risks and being loving and caring. God's wonderful word. We're going to listen from the psalmist at Psalm 118. Thank you, Edith, for that reading from the wonderful gospel of Jesus Christ. We stand as we're able again to sing our second hymn this morning, which is Open Our Eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus, to reach out and touch him and help him. Open our ears and help us to listen. Open our eyes, Lord. We want to see Jesus. Sacrificial and living body. Amen. lesson in three parts this morning, so having just heard the reading from both the Psalm and John's Gospel, I want you to take you to a city called Liverpool. So the words I'm going to use, you might need Paul's help in understanding. But the thing was that during 1981, I was an inspector in charge of a riot squad in Leicester. And during 3 nights of intense rioting, something from petrol bombing, bricks, and everything you could name. But the thing about me was that it was always my blessing to be a Christian police officer. And although at the time you might not think closely to what God is doing in these things, nevertheless, when you look backwards, particularly as you grow older, you become very aware of how God's hand is over you. And I never cease to be amazed that not one of those missiles struck any of my officers or myself, although we were probably the most active unit in reclaiming the city centre and preventing serious injury and damage. But we got sent up to Liverpool a few weeks later because Toxteth was, as they described it, was kicking off big time. There was a demonstration against the then Chief Constable, Ken Oxford, and they'd asked for mutual aid. Well, apart from finding our way to Hope House, which was then their old police headquarters, I knew very little about Liverpool. Last time I'd been there, I was about 4 years old. And it was more towards Birkenhead rather than Liverpool. But the thing is that when we got there, the senior officer just said, well, there's going to be this demonstration. We want you to be on the back of the demonstration. And other than that, there was nothing to tell us. So that's a fine bridge, isn't it? So they put us in this street called Home Street, which is a cul-de-sac, and we parked down there to wait a couple of hours until this plane was right. But we noticed on this car park, which was empty on the day, there were some young scousers, some young lads, playing footy, as they called it. Well, after about 10 or 15 minutes, there's a knock on my window of my van. So I wind the window down, and there's this young scouser. He said, "Hey, mister." I said, "Yeah." He says, "Can you play footy with the scuppers?" And I looked at him. He said, "Who says?" He says, "That scuffer with Tommy, stripes on his arm." Says, "Go and ask him in," meaning you. I said, "Well, you tell that scuffer with stripes on his arms, as long as they take the tunics off and the ties off, yes, they can play footy." So they did. And this went on for a good 40 minutes. And then I got the call on the radio saying to start getting ourselves ready. So I sent the signal out. And the game came to an end. And this little lad came running over again and said, "Hey, mister." I said, "Yes." He says, "Thanks." He says, "Scuffers up here don't play footy with you." There was something that said, "Okay. Glad you enjoyed yourself." And then the sergeant came over to me and he said, "Boss, while we're playing footy, the kids told us what was going to happen today. The intention is after the parade, they're going to return to the city and loot the city centre." In that one game of football, trust was established where there had been no trust between that community and the police. Once again, it's that unconditional acceptance of one another and being willing to go the extra mile to reach out to people in a very unassuming and natural way. And again, I look back and think, yes, God was active in the spirit in that simple coming together. Our next hymn speaks very much about what we hold dear in life and what's so important to us. So it stands again as we're able to sing Well, I once held dear, built my life upon, loving you, Jesus. There is no one. The story in Liverpool continues. outer of the city, and they're now down by the Liverbirds, and you know those two huge Port of Liverpool buildings. There's a pier there. They gathered on there, the politicians, to spout their message of dogma, the media there to catch whatever there was to report on. And then there came a time when the media and the politicians had disappeared, and what was left were the people. And I remember a chief inspector running over to me and saying, "You've got to stop them from going in the city centre." Well, I had 35 officers, and so did my colleague. But 70 police officers can in no way cover that huge expanse of anybody going in from the city centre. But the crowd came off the pier and they were throwing missiles at them in Somerset. But I saw one of the stewards with an armband came running forward and said, "Get out of the way, we're going into the city." And I said, "I'm sorry to inform you, but you're not. I've got to ask you to please turn your followers and go back to Liverpool Lane to Toxteth." And he said, "No truncheons there." And I just looked him in the eyes and I said, "If my officers are attacked, they will defend themselves, being no doubt of that. I'll ask you again, please turn the crowd the way you should." Well, there were six of them, and they all had steel armbands on. And I saw this crowd coming towards us. And that's the moment when you're thinking, here we go. And then the last moment, they linked arms into an arc. The crowd turned, following that road, back to Toxteth. And our officers fell in alongside them. It was the first time they'd been properly accompanied that day until we were asked to fall back by the officers in command. Learning to trust again is so important. I didn't know, but during lockdown I watched a documentary about Toxteth, and it was about Michael Heseltine being sent by Maggie Thatcher to meet with the people of Toxteth and to listen. And if you listen to Michael Heseltine after that meeting, he was a changed character in the way he talked his politics. But the thing about it was, I saw a man on the television, because it was at the same time back in 1981, and he was the very man I spoke to. Once again, reaching out, taking a risk, having the faith to trust, and then leaving it all to God, and God had turned the crowd. But it was by being loving and concerned, and not being aggressive or demanding, this conciliar way of building God's kingdom. Pales into insignificance in what's happening in the Ukraine at the moment, but nevertheless, is the people of the Ukraine, how many people, thousands, would come back over the border to worship in their home churches on Easter Day. They put their faith in front of fear. They're trusting in the God who has given them eternal life in Christ. What about Thomas? Everybody calls him Doubting Thomas. You couldn't be more unfair. You really couldn't. None of us know in that gospel or that first evening why Thomas wasn't there. I don't think he'd gone out to get a super Mac or something like that, because it didn't exist in those days. But the thing is, he wasn't there. Jesus appears behind locked doors. Now, come on. I've battered doors down in my time, but I've never actually managed to just pass through the door. And yet there was 10 disciples in that upper room. If I'd been there, I'd have dived under the table out of sheer shame, because of the way that all 11 of them had just gone. The 12th one was dead. The 12th one had sacrificed. gain for the world. When you'd expect so, would they stop doing for a minute? They probably were. What do you say? And what does Jesus say? Shalom. Peace be with you. The last thing they expected, having betrayed him, was the offer of peace. But those, just those few words, and all their fear, all their anxiety, and all their guilt, just flowed away. Look at my scars. Know it's me. And he breathed the Holy Spirit upon them, giving them courage and strength and a new realization that they were in the presence of the divine. The God taken flesh in Jesus Christ was now in his divinity. He knew that they couldn't wait for Pentecost. They needed to have the gift of the Spirit now. And those instructions to them is that you may now in the world forgive sins where they are to be forgiven. And to withhold that forgiveness if people will not repent and turn. It would be so easy to say, okay, what about Thomas? Well, the next time, the following Sunday, they're there together again. This time, Thomas is there. Thomas, of course, previously, had come back into the room and said, "You've seen Jesus. How would you feel?" Just think about it. On that last night together, you get it in John 14. Trust in God, trust in me. In my Father's house, there are many mansions, and I go and prepare a place for you. And you know the way I'm going. What does Thomas say? "Lord, we don't know the way, so how can we know? I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me." But he's going to prepare a place. So you understand it, Thomas. We don't know how many of the disciples stood at the foot of the cross and witnessed. But he obviously knew that Jesus' hands had been nailed, and he'd seen and he'd suffered that agony and that loss of love poured out. He'd seen a spear stuck in his side and the body fluid flowing away. He'd witnessed all that. I think Thomas was quite, for me, a very deeply sensitive and caring man. And there was a side of him, the human nature, to say to them, "This is a wonder, isn't it?" And we had Mary Magdalene, and she came along the other end, all saying they'd seen Jesus, or certain sheep had, and he'd spoken to them. But do you remember what Jesus said to Mary when she recognized him and fell on her knees and clutched hold of him? "Don't hold on to me, Mary. I have not yet ascended to the Father." Jesus knew his heart of heart. He had to send the Spirit to give them what they needed to do his ministry and work. But then Thomas calms down. No, he could tell by the way they were that Jesus had been among them. But the sheer agony of missing that moment. So this time, he's present. And Jesus says, "Come on, Thomas. I know you understand through your head, not necessarily through your heart. Come and put your finger in these wounds, these scars. Come and believe. I am risen. Rejoice with me and your fellow disciples. Come on, find your courage." "My Lord and my God," is his exclamation. The sheer privilege for Thomas could have been just left. He wasn't there. It's his fault. No, Jesus cares for every last fallen one. And they were all fallen, and yet Jesus was to lift them up through the peace that he offered them. Jesus offers you and I that same peace this day. But we're the ones he was talking about when he said, do you believe because of what you have done, and what you have seen me? How blessed are those who believe and yet have not seen. And dear friends, I see Jesus at this moment as I look around this church. I see the risen Christ and the body of Christ, which we are all called to be members of. Not to run away from, but to acknowledge that we are the body of Christ today. There's a story of St. Francis who longed to suffer the way his Lord did. And one morning after a night of prayer, he awoke to find stigmata on his hands and his feet. The thing is, the mystery of faith is that Jesus offers us his shalom. And we know that he ascended. And we know that he sent the Holy Spirit. Because once the Spirit is within us and upon us, how can we say no? How can we refuse to accept and believe? We have to go out and tell the story, but we tell the story through our lives. And we help other people to believe. The last little anecdote in the prison, going to see a very violent young man in the punishment unit. The officers were really, really worried about him. They could do nothing with him. And saying, open the door, but boss, because even the chaplain's got called boss. We don't open the doors, and say, open the door, please. There's three of you here. I remember going in, and yes, he was spitting and snarling. But I did the unmentionable. I something told me to walk into his space. And all of a sudden he started crying. And he calmed down. This is the gift of love, that unconditionally, if you let fear dominate you, it will. And our calling today is to overcome our fear of COVID and all that we've been through, to learn to trust again. To trust in the Lord who has brought us through, but now calls us to be his living body in the world. Will you do that? Can you do that? Can you go and tell others? Let me tell you about my Lord. Let me tell you what he's done for me. In my life, my dad, not long before he died in 1994, he says, when I look back over my life, he's been with me all the way, and he's never let me down. He's never let me down. And that is the truth, friends. You can look back, each one of you, and you'll know, sometimes the tragedy of death of a loved one, sometimes through a serious accident or illness or whatever it may be, you'll know this moment. And you look back. Praise the Lord. For he is good. And his goodness endures forever. Amen. We stand again as we're able to sing the hymn, God forgave my sin, in Jesus' name. I've been born again, in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.
Come to you.
Lord Jesus, following your example, we gather in a quiet place to pray to the Father through you. We begin these prayers, dear God. I speak to you about those who we know who are in need. Those who are sick. Those for whom life is coming towards its end. Those who feel lonely, lost and abandoned. Those who care for others and yet feel unloved and cared for in return. And in the silence we speak fairly. Within the churches of our area, O God, we remember this day Jeff Eriks, his wife Mo. Tony Hudson and his wife Pauline. Chairman Dupina, for Prince, for Tumi Muleta, as we pray for them now, may your spirit move upon them and within them. Lift them and raise them, O God. Grant healing for who and for those where it is possible. And for others, offer wholeness and understanding as they put their trust in you. O Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord God, pray for your world. Especially we think again of the Ukraine, its leaders and those who serve to repel the warring hordes from Russia. And we pray for your royal protection over the innocent. Families, for they suffer from no fault of their own, but because of the power of evil. And we ask you to raise up in Russia people of conscience and heart, that they may bring to bear what is needed to remove those who wage war, and for the return of peace. We pray for the Yemen, again where people are driven from their homes. And we pray for ongoing strife between Israeli and Palestinian. Pray for those who starve, who have no home to call their own. And we think of Zimbabwe. serve the risen Jesus, in rebuilding, in providing homes and welcomes where there's been none. Help our nation to find a better way of being alongside refugees and not looking for political solutions, but answers driven by love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And Lord, we pray for our nation, we pray for your church today. We pray for the movement of the Spirit, that all who call you God, for all who call Jesus Lord, may find the courage, may be moved by your Spirit, our Holy Spirit, to begin to trust again, to begin again the work, to begin again the caring and the reaching out, to begin the building of your kingdom, wherever they find themselves. We pray for the churches of our area. We pray for Martin and his leadership and the team built around him that will enable each church in his community to serve, to grow and become again. Bless each of your children here. Let them know your purpose for them this day, and in the days and the weeks ahead. For you love them so much. And in return, we offer ourselves as a living sacrifice, as we walk with Jesus. And we learn through him and through one another. Trust me. Amen. Closing hymn this morning is a challenge to all of us. It's a wake-up call. Time to go out into the community and go forth, enjoy and be in peace. And let the whole world, let the mountains, trees, because you know something, when Christians walk in the power of the Spirit, joy bursts out into the world as you share your love. You shall go out with joy.
Thank you.
Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, rest and abide with each one of us and those who we